Alright, thank you everyone for coming. It's awesome that we got to do this again now the second time, so we had so much fun the first time. So thank you for coming. I'm Danny, this is Dana, and we use flexible dieting sort of in our everyday life. So for on stage, off stage, and we love this method of dieting. So the thing is with nutrition, everyone's sort of got their own way that works best for them. And so this is just one of them. We're sort of not here to tell you that this is the only approach you can take to reach your goals. This is just one of many, okay? So we're here to simplify things for you and just give you a better overall understanding of one of the methods that we both love. Cool, all right, good stuff. So, as Danny was saying, a bit of an overview. We're gonna go through what all the macros are, explaining what foods they're in and everything as well, meal timing, supplements, myths, you know, all those kind of things that I guess are confusing in the nutrition kind of world, and hopefully break it down and make it simple, because when it comes down to simplicity, that's the easiest thing, all right? There's so many other things you can do that might work for other people, but we just want to break it down to basics and make it easy for you and build a good relationship with food, okay? I guess that's the first. A big underlining thing that both of us believe is we don't want to use food or exercise as a punishment. You know, we want to enjoy our food, enjoy going out, and enjoy training as well. All right?
Let's hear a bit about backgrounds first.
Bit about backgrounds first, so that would be probably good. All right, so so my background is predominantly in sports. I grew up as an athlete and ended up taking my soccer to America and played 4 years of college over there. While I was over there, I studied uni with a double degree in sports science and psychology. While playing soccer, they're quite, it's like semi-professional, so we were training, you know, 2 times a day. We're on strict weightlifting programs, we're on strict diet programs as well, all to get the best out of our performance. So from about 18, I was put into that environment, and then I kind of brought that back here and then tried to implement it to the more general population, right? So my training methods are a little bit different. There's a bit of powerlifting, it's a bit of bodybuilding, it's a bit of athletic conditioning, and then there's a little bit of cardio in there, a little teeny tiny bit. Right, so that's me. Yeah, Danny.
Cool. So I started off playing sport as well. I played tennis for about 13 years. I have then transitioned into this fitness world that we're sort of all in now. So I've been doing weight training a bit more seriously for about 4 years and became a trainer that time as well. So just fell in love with that side of it. I competed in my first show last year, I did 2 of them, and used flexible dieting to get on stage. After prep as well, I've sort of continued to use flexible dieting and will be competing again at the start of next year. So that's sort of the area that I'm gonna go down now. In terms of education, so I'm currently studying osteopathy. I'm in my 4th year at the moment, and I have a degree in exercise science as well. And qualified with metabolic precision, which Dana is as well. So that taught us a little bit about the body and the metabolism and just a little bit more detail about nutrition as well. So let's get into it. That's me, straight into it, cool. So nutrition, you would have heard, is probably more important than exercise. So that really just leads us to our results. We think that when we exercise, we can get away with eating whatever we want. You know, I've just done a massive workout, I can go home and eat burgers or donuts, I deserve this sort of thing. Very common. The thing is with that, it takes so much longer to burn off calories than it does to, you know, eat them. Yes. So that's the problem. Normally, we sort of end up overeating. So as an example, moderate intensity activity burns about 300 to 400 calories an hour, give or take, depending on what you do. A cheeseburger and Macca's is over 500 calories like that, 10 minutes tops. Just being aware that they take a lot longer to burn. In saying that, all we're gonna talk about today is as well is just sort of matching up your food intake with your exercise levels a bit better as well, so you can sort of get away with it.
Alright, so what do I eat? Kind of touch base on it a little bit, but biggest thing is that there is no best thing, alright? There's something that works for you, and unfortunately you've just got to go through everything to find out what works best, alright? Some people work good with lots of carbs, some people work good with high fats, some people,
you know, work with 3 meals a day. Some people work with 6 meals a day, all right? So me and Danny already in front of you are very different. She doesn't process, well, she doesn't do well with carbs as such. I can just eat rice and potatoes and all the carbs till the cows come home and it'll just go straight away. Right, so everyone's different, so just find what works for you. I think a lot of us just jump into something and then we're like, oh, it doesn't work, I'm just gonna go back to eating crap every day. And it's not like that. You just gotta keep trucking along. If something doesn't work, don't think of it as a failure or I've done it wrong or this or that. It's just, it's not you, you've ticked that one off, move on to the next one. All right, so it's a constant learning curve just in life. We're learning everything as we go. So just learn what works for you, all right? Now macros, you'll hear us talk about macros quite a lot. So what are macros? Who has any experience with nutrition here? Who's, oh my God, I don't even know what questions to ask.
Who knows what macros are?
So we've got kind of a basic understanding of nutrition, yeah, on the whole. Cool. We're quite interactive. I like to make funny, so just be prepared for a little bit of informative fun, all right? So macros, Dan,
cool.
The best one,
so starting off with protein. This is the most common macronutrient that is under-eaten because people often associate protein with getting bulky, getting fat, you know, eating meat, like animal after animal, but it's not, you know? It's really important because this is what shapes our body. So some of the benefits, this is what builds our muscles. The little building blocks that create our muscles fuels your recovery. Without it, we'll just be sore all the time after workouts. We won't be rebuilding, which is what sort of exercise is. Breaking down the muscles, using that protein to rebuild it. It makes you fuller for longer as well. So the more protein you eat, you will have less cravings for your carbs and fats and sugary foods. As I sort of said, it changes your body composition, so it tones you up, which we'll sort of touch on later. Food sources, of course, your meats and things, dairy as well. Seafood, and there are lots of vegan options out there, vegetarian, quinoa, buckwheat, tofu, etc. Vegetables have small amounts and things, you can get little amounts here and there also, but they're your sort of main food sources. In terms of how much to eat, the general rule is to sort of aim for 2 grams of protein per kilo of body weight. So if you weigh 60 kilos, you'll be eating 120 grams of protein, essentially. Per day. Yeah, so per meal, we'll sort of touch on it as well, around 30-ish grams, which will teach you how to find out how many grams of protein are in what food as well. Cool question. Feel free to ask any questions through as we go along, guys. Yeah, so the thing is, the Australian Dietary Guidelines sort of estimate about like less protein than that, but in terms of like the fitness industry and if we want to sort of change our body composition, we do need to up it a little bit. So Australian Dietary Guidelines are sort of 0.75 per gram, but you're safe eating 2 grams. Any other questions on protein?
Cool. Right, carbohydrates, right? This is the evil of the nutrition world, isn't it? You know, you eat carbs, you're gonna get fat. But what are carbs, all right? Carbs are the body's main source of fuel, all right? Main source of energy. It's just easiest for the body to break down. It's stored in all of our muscles, so that's where it gets drawn from, all right? It allows you to have better workouts, right? More energy, better workouts, and just day-to-day functions, okay? I'm sure you guys can relate that maybe if you haven't eaten for the day, you're feeling lethargic, you know, your mind can't focus, your brain function isn't up, then you have, you know, a good nutritious meal and you feel top notch, right? So carbohydrates allow us to do things, to live everyday life. All right, so there's different sources of carbs. You've got high energy carbs, which are great around a workout because they're fast digesting. So things like your rice, your pastas, your oats, the carbs that are bad for you, they're really good pre and post workout because they're gonna go straight to use for energy, right? You can still have them at other times of the day, I'm not saying that. That's just when they're really, really good, right? Then you've got your lower energy carbs, which you can have any time, as much as you want, go absolutely crazy, and that's more of your fruits, your vegetables, your beans, your legumes, and stuff like that too. So the low energy carbs you kind of stuff your meals up with, and they're the ones you want to get most of, and then your high energy carbs, I mean, I eat them with every meal, but I know not everybody does, so they're kind of in less quantity, low ones, more, less. Cool. Does that make sense? Awesome. I feel like I just circle around a whole bunch of times, so I'm just going to break it down. alright? So you do not need to cut out carbs to lose weight. We'll touch base on a bit of myths about that soon. But please, please, please don't eliminate carbs from your diet unless you are intolerant to them or your body is super, super sensitive, which rarely people are. You don't need to eliminate carbs entirely from your diet, all right? So if there's one thing you're going to go home with, it's don't eliminate carbs, all right?
Yes, I love that.
Good.
Yes. Good. All about it. All right, fats. So we may have heard about good and bad fats, but essentially, you know, it's all right to eat them within moderation, which that's what we're all about, moderation, not about cutting anything out, okay? So fats are essential for your hormones, for your bodily functions as well. So without them, you know, things don't really work optimally. Recovery as well, and we put insulation in there, you know. So the good fats are made of omega-3s. So they're your fish, avocados, nuts, seeds, etc. Bad fats, which we don't really like using the term bad, but it's one that people can sort of relate to. So there's your omega-6, that's all your deep fried processed stuff, okay? Again, not all bad. We'll teach you ways that you can incorporate them as well without being too detrimental. So the thing is with fats, they're so easy to overconsume, and that's where people often like lose track. So like, for example, one serving of almonds is probably 6 to 10, but you know, by the time we sort of grab a handful of almonds, you've got a decent chunk there, and then your fats can creep up in that sense. So that's often where people sort of steer away. Yeah, so fats really important.
Meal timing and composition, right? So on the whole, try and include all the macronutrients in your meals, okay? So you got your proteins, your carbs, and your fats. Try and include a little bit of them in every meal. Ideally, look, I like 5 or 6 meals a day. I think that it keeps you full throughout the day. It keeps you sustained. I know for some people's work-life balance and everything, it's just not possible to eat that much fruit. It is a pain in the bum to eat that much fruit. So, you know, you can go to 3 or 4, but just make them larger, all right? So my meal size would be different to your meal size if you were eating 3 meals a day. So again, it's up to the individual from there. Okay, a big thing I'm big on, oh my gosh, all right? I'm big on breakfast, all right? So you wanna get breakfast in. If you can't do it right when you wake up, that's okay. Maybe you get dressed, you go to work, and then you eat it at work. But maybe within like an hour of when you wake up or so, just to give your body that kickstart, all right? So we wake up to the sound of our alarm in the morning. Our body doesn't do that, okay? We need to give it food for it to go, all right, I'm ready. I'm going to make it happen, okay? So try and get breakfast in. It doesn't have to be eggs on toast or anything. It can start out as a protein shake. And then you can up it to a smoothie with berries, maybe some oats in there as well. And then you can up it to eggs on toast if you've got time for that. Okay, so it's not about changing the world overnight. It's about making small progressions, right? If you have 6 cans of Coke every day, don't eliminate Coke because you're gonna go crazy. Maybe have 2 a day, right? And that's a huge step. So that's what it's about, okay? So another thing to take away, try to get breakfast in every day just to make that one step. In terms of your calories and everything, if you're severely under eating, then that's going to give you, you know, a good 200-300 calorie booster as well. So it's keeping you closer towards your goals. All right, as I said, around carbs, eat most of your high energy carbs around workouts. It'll just get absorbed a lot quicker. Your body will utilize it a lot more, and it just replenishes your broken muscle stores. So protein helps to build your muscles, and as I said, carbohydrates are stored within your muscles. So you can just replenish that and keep your body. Your body wants to be, it's called homeostasis. Your body wants to be okay all the time, and that's what food is doing, is making your body okay. All right, big words tonight, done.
Can I ask one question?
You certainly can. Two.
There's two of them, yeah.
At the back, yes.
Yeah, we're great.
Middle, back. Yeah, what was your question?
With having breakfast, you say you need to wake up your body. Should you then have it before a morning workout?
That's exactly what I was
going to
ask, because I do a workout about 6 a.m.
Ideally, you know, you want something in your stomach before your workout, just because we go whatever amount of hours we're sleeping, say 6 to 8 hours, without any nutrients, without any protein, you know, and then so that means your muscles don't have that optimal, like, energy store. So we want to have our metabolism sort of running before we work out, A, for energy, and B, so we're not breaking down all that muscle that we've worked so hard for, you know? So it's like a little energy boost sort of thing. A eventually, as Dana was saying, you can build up to it. If you start your morning with half a banana, and if that's a step more than what you used to do, which was not have breakfast, then you're winning, yeah? So your body will eventually adapt, and then you can add more and more and more. If it's a time factor, just try and get something in, like a shake, something that won't be sitting in your stomach as much, but definitely recommend workout, eat before a workout.
So I normally have my breakfast after.
Yeah. Try and just maybe just have a portion of it before, personally. You know, that's what we find works best. Again, people are different. You will hear a lot of things about fasted workouts and things like that. But personally, I believe that it can lead to muscle breakdown unless you're sort of being really specific and that. But again, we're just sort of talking to a general population here. We want something sustainable, not too crazy on the body. So definitely eat before a workout. Yeah. Any further questions on that topic? Or any other topic in general? No?
I have one.
Yeah.
How late can you eat at night? Like the opposite of that. So you talked about that you're not fast, or you're fasting for 8 hours or whatever it is. Can you use things like protein before you go to bed to kind of help? Because I've had instances where I wake up in the middle of the night and be completely starving.
Oh, yeah.
How late can you actually eat?
Yeah, so there's actually no rule with that. You can eat 30 seconds before you go to sleep. Yeah, you're excited about that? I know, everyone thinks that you can't eat before bed.
And I just go to bed, and then while you sleep, I'm just like, oh.
Yeah.
And my stepdad's like, you eat because you're lonely. I'm like, no, I eat because I'm hungry. Like,
energy you've sort of expended during your workouts and life in general. So eating before bed allows you to have those nutrients in your stomach while you're rebuilding and recovering, so it's going to grab it straight away. Anything you want to add to that?
Yeah, I eat every night before bed. I eat probably about 10 or 10:30, sometimes 11 if it's a late night. And I wake up, and I'm like you, I wake up in the morning and I am starving.
Yeah.
And then I'll eat again at 4 a.m. So that's just what's when I get up. So. Yeah,
I don't, so don't worry about that. You don't have to get up before I am.
Don't do that.
What type of foods are you eating though?
So before bed, yogurt and muesli is my current go-to. So I have some yogurt, I have protein in the yogurt, I've got a muesli that I'm just obsessed with, and then some fruits and stuff like that. So a little bit of sugars and stuff, which has thought crossed my mind, but that's what I feel like at that time. And then when I wake up, my current go-to is oats, so it'd be oats, protein powder, and then some more berries, bucket in the microwave, and you're good, right? So,
it's just a source of protein, carbs,
protein and fats.
Or probably less fats in that sort of example that you gave, but it doesn't actually matter about the food, like the exact food that you eat, as long as you're hitting those macros, and that's why we're here today. So the three macros are what we're concerned about, not necessarily which food is optimal sort of thing, yeah? So a protein, carb and fat source of your choice. That's what we'll teach you how to utilize today.
Even if it's a protein shake, that's good for me too.
Exactly, so
cool.
Yeah.
All right, move on. Most of your questions will get answered as we go. All right, so some myths that we're gonna cover. All right, so will carbs make me fat? I think we already know the answer to that, but we're gonna touch base on it again because, surprise, surprise, it's something that we want to help you with. All right. Will training make me bulky? All right, women, will weight training make me bulky? I hear this every single day. And I'm sorry, I don't want to bang your heads against the wall anymore. So I think as women that do weight train, hopefully can give you a little bit of insight on that. If I hardly eat, will I lose weight, all right? So you need to, in order to lose weight, you've got to eat less. So if you don't eat at all, you're going to lose a bunch of weight, right?
Maybe.
We'll see. All right, training multiple times a day. So similar to under eating, if you train more, you'll get better results. And does flexible dieting mean you can eat burgers every day? okay? So these are just some things that we constantly hear all the time, and some things we just kind of want to squash, and another one about supplements, all right? So you'll see this all the time, mentioned like fasted cardio and stuff like that. A lot of these things, when you're getting into, 4% body fat and all the bodybuilders, and you see some of the big guys and some of the really, really big girls in the gym, that's completely different, right? That's a different world. You don't need to follow that stuff, right? They're doing things to very extreme to their body, because when you get down to a certain weight, you need to do that, right? So there's nothing wrong with that. That's great. We've both been through it, but this is more just living life, enjoying life, and not hating every time that you have a wine or a Palmer. I said Palmer tonight.
Oh,
a wine or a Palmer, right? Last time I think I said Palmer about 20 times.
Yes.
So will carbs make me fat?
Alright, so no, they will not. They are so essential to our functioning and our results and our life.
That's great.
Great. She wants to give me a hug. I can tell, I can feel it.
She
wants
good.
Spread the love around. Carbs will not make you fat, no matter if you eat them before bed, no matter if you eat them in the morning, it doesn't matter. The only thing that will make people put on weight is if you eat more calories than what you burn, okay? That is the golden rule. And that's why we're here today, to really just put that out there. So, essential for optimal functioning, as we have said. So, with low carbs, it is a short-term weight loss. A lot of those challenges sort of on TV and shows and things like that, yeah, short-term, but yeah, the body's smarter than that. And it knows how to adapt, which we'll touch on in a later slide. You get tired. Poor performance in the gym, because again, carbs are your energy source, yeah? So you're not going to be training as hard and your workouts will not be optimal at all. And then it can lead to unhealthy relationship with food, okay? The amount of times you hear people saying, nah, not eating carbs today, and they're sitting there out to dinner and they're eating and they're just hating life. Why? There's no point, There are ways around that.
Do they make you bloat, though?
They can. Fiber as well. So carbs do contain fiber, especially some of your vegetables and grains and things like that, and some people are a little bit intolerant to it. So if you're sort of, the app that we're going to tell you about sort of teaches you how much fiber is in things as well, and you'll be able to gauge, and then if you do feel sort of bloated, slightly lower your fiber or try different sources as well. So that can happen with carbs, just depends on the type of carb, I'd say. Bloating is often really associated with fiber. Have a play around with your fiber levels.
So what about white bread then? Should you start off on white bread totally?
No.
Because I was told that white bread's really bad.
Yeah, so people sort of, there is less fiber and it is sort of a higher energy food, which we sort of touched on. So optimally, if you did want to sort of have your white bread, again, in an optimal world, you'd have it sort of before or after your workout. Again, it's not going to kill you if you don't have it immediately. If you're not training that day and you have it, you're not going to sort of ruin your results.
It's like a bad breakfast, say, in a rush, you said, would you want to show someone, for example, it's going to be a bad breakfast?
Well, without using the word bad, because again, nothing is off limits, yeah? So no food is off limits unless you're intolerant to it. There are other sources of food that are more optimal. So a Vegemite toast, if you're in a rush, it's just carbs. So there's no protein, which will make you full. There's no fats, which will sort of help you be full again and, utilize your hormones and things like that. Vegemite toast, once your metabolism speeds up, not even touch the sides. So again, we want to sort of create meals that, convenient, but will keep you fuller, so then you're not starving by the time it's your next meal, and that's when the cravings come in. If you have a nice breakfast prepared the night before, full of your protein, fats, and carbs, chances of your cravings spiking and you're feeling tired during the day are very minimal. So there are better options than others, but nothing is off limits, if that makes sense.
Yeah, that's right.
I think in a slide coming up, we've got essentially not all calories are created equally, right? So you can eat 500 calories of broccoli and 500 calories of white bread, and you may get, four slices of white bread, but then your 500 calories of broccoli could be like this table. So you're gonna be a lot more full on a table full of broccoli than you are on white bread, right? So you can still eat, you can eat Maccas every day, you'll feel a bit crappy, but if you eat 2,000 calories worth of Maccas, then you won't gain weight, essentially. You'll just be hungry because there's nothing in
it's
it.
It's just one meal that you've had all day.
Yeah, so the more nourishing food, will keep you fuller for longer. So we'll get into a little bit more like not all calories are created equally, but that's a perfect example.
Yeah, loving the questions, guys.
Yeah, right. So will weightlifting make me bulky? All right. Now, if any of you girls in here are worried about picking up weights, because you're going to get bulky, if you do, come and talk to me and Dan, right? We've both been training for, you know, better part of 5 years to try and get bulky, you know, not like massive, but try and put on muscle. And we train probably, you know, 5-6 days a week, and we're not that big, all right? So...
Oh, come on, mate, I thought I was all right.
Yeah, Photoshop, though.
Photoshop. Put a good filter on, and, you know.
So in order to look like the bodybuilder women that are just massive, it is strict dieting. It is strict in the weight room as well. It is marrying the two up, all right? So weightlifting is the best form of exercise that you can do, right? So we've all seen pictures like this before, and that's all good and well. So just saying that, like, muscle is a tighter filament in the body, right? So that kind of is a little bit larger. That didn't make much sense.
Like,
so
it's more dense.
It's more dense.
You can have the same weight, but muscle is way more dense. Fat takes up more space.
Yeah, cool. Perfect. All right. So muscle is good. We want more muscle. Muscle burns more fat. All right. So if I weigh 50 kilos and I'm just a ball of muscle, and someone next to me weighs 50 kilos and they have no muscle, my metabolism is just going to be kicking over, and I'm going to be actually just burning calories as I'm sitting there breathing, because your muscle requires energy in order to sustain itself, all right? Fat doesn't as such, all right? So the more muscle you have, the more calories you're just burning, just living, all right? So you'll see when you're on your apps is really good, because as your weight kind of changes, your food will change as well. So you're not going to eat the same thing for the rest of your life if your body composition changes. All right, so toning up, all right? Danny did this before, toning up, okay? There is no such thing as toning up, I'm really sorry, girls, but it is increasing muscle, right? Toning up is increasing muscle. Your muscles either get bigger or they get smaller. You can't circle, you know, you can't make your delts a little bit rounder. You know, you can't work on, you know, your second left ab or anything like that. You can just increase the muscle or you can decrease it. And toning up is increasing the muscle and decreasing your fat, okay? So just lift weights. And that's going to get it done.
I think sort of the stereotype with being bulky means, like, yeah, if you do heaps of weight training and powerlifting and things like that, you will increase your muscle mass, but yeah, it's if your diet, if you're increasing your calories as well, that's when you're going to store the fat on top of the muscle, okay? So that's where a bulky look can come from. But there's no reason why if your diet, if your calories are matching up with your exercise and things like that, there's no reason why you look bulky. And yeah, it is very hard to put on muscle.
Yeah. Well, like, yeah, some of the girls that you see, like there's a couple of, like, big girls in here, which is awesome. Like they train, like girls train for like 10 plus years to be in like figure and physique and bodybuilding and stuff like that. Like it takes years and years of work,
yeah.
Right? So yeah, definitely get on the weights, guys.
Yeah.
There was a question.
Yeah, I was just gonna say, do some people tend to bulk in areas differently?
Yes, so your fat would be stored in different areas, all right? So lucky for us ladies, we store our fat just here, all right? So it will go, you will lose weight all over, but you will store your fat in certain areas, right? Guys tend to be a little bit more around the midsection. Females is kind of in your bum and in your butt handles and stuff like that. So it does come down, it does come off. Unfortunately, it's just the last place that it comes off. Right? So you can thank good old reproductive systems for that, because as we said when we spoke about fats, insulation, it is protecting all our vital organs and everything. Right? So yes, that's okay. Just work harder for it.
Yeah, and doing a million sit-ups is not going to just make us lose weight from here as well. So yeah, unfortunately.
Yeah.
So it is, to get abs, you've got to just be low body fat, and that's, you can get abs by squatting really heavy, yeah? So the more muscle you have on any, like anywhere in the body, that will help you get abs, because that seems to be everyone's goal, is like, I want abs, but yeah. So since that's the last sort of area to go, that's the hardest thing. People have been sad, I'm sorry.
Planking
are good for inner core, but yeah. It's all good, definitely still train abs, but don't go every day like trying to smash your abs in order to get a six-pack. So this photo is awesome. It's basically saying to ditch the scales, you saw that photo before, that the same weight of muscle and fat is a completely different shape. So we're all about using progress pictures and measurements to track your progress and just how you feel, how you're performing in the gym, how your clothes are fitting. That's how you can generally tell, yeah? It's so easy to become obsessive with the scales, but it's just a number in the end, because as you are decreasing your fat and putting on your muscle, that you're gonna sort of still weigh the same anyway. So it's really good to not get caught up on that. Take lots of progress pictures, that you don't have to post them anywhere, just for yourself, just as a reminder, you know? We see ourselves every day and it's so easy to forget how far you've come. Then you look at an old photo and then that's your motivation there. So try not to get too caught up on the scales. That's our main thing. So with this photo before you make it disappear. This girl here, in the left picture, it's in pounds, but 145 pounds on the left. She lost weight, sort of lots of cardio and things like that. 122 pounds in the middle picture, not that much of a difference. And then in the last one, lots of weight training, things like that, 140 pounds. So 5 pound difference between the first and last photo, only because she's put on lots of muscle mass in the last one. Again, everyone's got different body goals, but she looks heaps happier in the last one, so we'll say that she's achieved her body goals.
All right, so does eating less mean that you lose more weight? All right, so no, it does not. It'll cause damage, all right? So you hear about like starvation mode and everything like that. Your body will go into metabolic damage if you under-eat, okay? So you wanna eat enough to keep your body sustained and have your daily functions going and be able to live life, but you don't wanna overeat that you're gonna then store it for later, all right? So there's a very fine line between there. Right, so eating less will cause your body to you'll release hunger signals into your brain, all right? Your body, as I said, wants to be okay. When you're hungry, it's just telling your brain, like, eat food, eat food, eat food. And when you're really, really hungry and tired, the first thing you're gonna want is sugar, because it's a quick energy hit. So that's where your cravings come from. Generally, when we have cravings, it's because we're tired or we're hungry, all right? Mine's definitely a tired craving. So you'll get to come to learn it, right? So it's also learning what your body wants. And when you have a craving, what is it? Is it an actual craving? Do you really want a cupcake? Or do you just think you want a cupcake because you're tired and you just need sugar? All right, so eating less also causes cortisol, all right? So it releases the stress hormone cortisol when your body is worried and in distress, releases cortisol, and that's going to just store fat and store water and store everything because it doesn't know when it's gonna get fed again. Okay, so your body will hold on to food because it needs to live and it doesn't know when it's going to get fed. So if you keep feeding it, it's going to know, all right, I can just get rid of all of this and use it because I know I'm going to get food later on. All right, so as Danny said a couple of times, your body is very smart and it will switch on to your habits. And as you, if you keep doing it and you're consistent with things, then your body will learn to adapt really, really quickly. Alright, eating less will cause a loss in strength, it'll cause muscle breakdown if you don't have the nutrients in your body to build your muscle. You can't build muscle, alright? Fatigue and irritability as well, definitely, that is hangry, and I think we've all been there a couple times. I actually ate before we came here today, so I'm feeling pretty good today.
Well, I thought you were a bit happier.
Yeah. Yeah. I was a little bit flat and confused
last
time.
That's
so
over here, I'm like, did you eat?
Causes vitamin deficiencies, all right? So you've got your micronutrients, which are just as important. So if you eat a diet of eggs and rice, that's all good and well and that's fantastic, but you're missing out on a lot of vitamins that, you know, will help with different absorption of things. It'll help with daily functioning as well, all right? So this is where the whole round diet comes in, making sure you're getting a little bit of everything so that you're getting all those vitamins and minerals as well as your macros, all right? So what we want to aim for is eating in a slight deficit, so enough that you're not, you know, running to the fridge every 2 seconds or constantly thinking about food. And you want to aim to drop about 1 to 2% of your body weight per week. All right, so that is about between 200 to 400-500 grams. All right, so I know a lot of us, you know, will be awesome for an entire week. We'll step on the scales and it says, you know, 200 grams. You're like, oh my God, it's not working. This is crap, etc., etc. You expect to drop 5 kilos or 2 kilos in a week or even a kilo in a week, but that's not maintainable, all right? So about 500 grams is a good number to look at. Even if it's 100 or 200, that's a drop from the start of the week. So don't beat yourselves up. Life is a long time, all right? So you've got, you know, 50, 60, 70 years. So yeah, you've got plenty of time to make it happen, all right?
I jump on the scales. I have been, you know, various times in my current challenge. I'm putting on 100 grams, you know, a week, or 200 grams a week,
mm-hmm.
but I feel like I'm being better.
Mm-hmm. Have you...
What's going on there?
Have you had any other forms of tracking progress, measurements, photos, things like that?
I take photos all the time to the point where my phone is...
Yeah, all right. Maybe try and get two that are similar. Have a look. Have I actually changed body composition? So, yeah, the whole...
Not enough,
putting on
I
muscle.
Don't think. Not enough for what the scales are saying.
How long have you been doing this challenge and what does it involve?
Okay, I finished a 12-week challenge. Now I'm doing another 8-week challenge.
Yeah.
So we're week 4.
Yeah.
At the moment. So last week I put on 300 grams. The week before was 100 grams.
Yep. What have they got you eating? Whatever you like.
I think I'm pretty good, generally.
Yeah.
I start my morning off with a protein shake. I have oats with Greek yogurt. For morning tea, that's got some nuts in it as well, so fats.
Yeah, good.
And a little bit of dried fruit, which possibly need to change up for berries.
Nothing's bad, remember? Dried fruit's okay.
Then lunch will be some brown rice, broccoli, beans, tuna, eggs, that sort of thing. Afternoon tea, maybe a protein shake. Go to the gym then, and then I'll go home and have dinner as well.
Yeah. Okay, so in this challenge they have they sort of got you, is that part of a meal plan or they're just what's the challenge, like an exercise challenge or a food, do they give you food advice? Like,
it's a strength challenge,
yeah?
I suppose.
Okay.
So 1 week we did squats, body weight, power to weight ratio, sorry, that's what
Okay.
Overhead press, this week's hand cleans.
Yeah, so a lot of sort of strength training. It could be you're putting on muscle mass.
But would I be putting on that much muscle?
Could be you're not eating enough. Could be a few things.
Which is what I hear a lot of.
Yeah, so especially if you've increased your training volume, again, your body's going, oh my God, I'm using so much more energy than what I normally do. I need to store energy. Like, if you don't sort of, yeah, that's what we're sort of talking about today. So matching up your food intake with your training. And I think, yeah, as we were sort of saying, these 12-week, 8-week challenges, we're not knocking them, like they're great, but a lot of it is for marketing, a lot of it is to make it appealing to people to go into these challenges, but they need to be long-term, so...
Which is what I do. Obviously,
yeah.
If I'm not doing a challenge, I'm doing my own thing.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, cool.
So yeah, you might be under-eating, or if you're having a lot of like nuts and stuff like that, could be very high fats. You might need to drop your fats down a little bit too, but...
We'll work at your levels.
Yeah,
today.
We'll... When we use MyFitnessPal, it'll be interesting to see what you're eating.
Yeah. So we'll get you to put it in and, we'll see. Don't be disheartened.
I'm bumping my head up against a brick wall.
Yeah, it is frustrating. Try and get progress pictures happening and measurements.
Yep.
Definitely. Because you could be worried about something and you're doing really well. And are you lifting heavier?
Yeah.
Good. Yeah, that's good. You're making progress.
There's definitely some muscle in there.
Definitely. Yeah, lifting heavier means muscle.
How often should you track things like that? I mean, I know everyone's slightly different, but, you know, sometimes you're either checking things too often or not often enough. So what's kind of a good kind of average where you should see some progress from changing your diet or exercise?
So essentially I wouldn't weigh yourself every day. I wouldn't obsess over it every day. Weekly, that's what I do with my clients, you're the same. Again, if you're finding weekly is too frequently for you and you're starting to stress over it, don't worry about it. If you feel good that you're performing better, you don't need to track yourself that often. It just, there's a fine line and everyone is different. Everyone has different behaviors and things like that. Again, just remember, am I performing better? How's my energy levels? Try and use that as your tracking as well at the same time. But weekly, if it doesn't affect you, if it doesn't make you obsessive, weekly's fine. Again, everyone's different.
Tighter and stronger.
But yeah, definitely. We need some. Sorry, guys.
Sorry.
So we need some sort of way to remind ourselves that we're improving because that's our motivation. That's why we track. Yeah.
lights. I've been doing a challenge. I'm currently in comp prep, and I've been doing 7 weeks. I'm 7 weeks in, and I do not think that I have changed at all. I've put a progress picture from week one to week seven, and it's a major difference.
Cool.
So I don't hardly ever weigh myself because I don't believe what's on the scale.
Good.
So if you think that you are not getting anywhere, always put the two pictures side by side because you'll be completely blown away by what you actually look like.
And how do you feel now after seeing that?
Amazing.
Yeah.
It's more motivation than anything, I think.
Perfect. There's a real life example. Congrats on getting into comp prep too.
Yeah.
September or October?
September.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Maybe watching you on stage. Beautiful.
Yeah. So like photos and how you feel probably is a better representation of it. And like you might be able to see weekly changes, but if you're somewhat healthy and fit, you'll only see minor things. So, you know, 7 weeks is a good chunk of time, maybe even monthly. I think monthly is a good progress picture, and then you can put them side by side together with that. So go with monthly pictures, weekly weighs, give that a go, see how it goes. If it drives you crazy, change it up.
Yeah, everyone's different at the end of the day.
Yeah.
Good, perfect.
Cool.
All right,
that helps.
Any other questions on that topic? Sort of switched around, didn't
we?
We did.
Oh, all right. Yeah, sure. Why not?
Go for it.
So training multiple times a day. Okay. Personally, I don't feel a need to train multiple times a day. If you can give 100% of your energy into one session, then fantastic. Go do that. Okay. In comp prep, okay, maybe a little bit different. If you're in pre-season for a sport, again, maybe a little bit different. If you have pretty much training multiple times a day for the majority of us is not going to be sustainable. And that's what we're trying to, I guess, put across is finding something that is sustainable so you don't think about it all the time. It just becomes a norm to go to the gym at 6 a.m. It just becomes norm to eat breakfast before you go. It just becomes norm to eat at 10 p.m. before you go to sleep. So overtraining is a real thing. And a lot of people fall into that, and then that will make you hold weight too. So again, your body is very quick. What is overtraining? Overtraining is doing too much, and your body isn't getting enough time to repair itself. So as Dan said, the work happens when you rest. So if you've hit a plateau, if you're not seeing any results, you're feeling a little bit lethargic, a little bit weak, your motivation's just gone, just literally don't come to the gym for, you know, 3, 4, 5, maybe 7 days, and then come back in a week and you will see so much more progress. You will be lifting heavier, you'll have more energy, and you'll probably find that you've lost a little bit of weight in that time as well. So this is a very mental thing. I know personally that I struggle a lot with the deload. But it is fantastic for your performance, all right? So, if you're doing two times a day, my suggestion is just put 100% in the first one, okay? So go all out in the first one. You don't need to be training for 3 hours at a time. You know, we've all got lives and jobs and we don't want to be a slave to the gym, right? We want to come here as a bit of a release, you know, have an hour and a half to yourself, and then go home, be with your family, do things that you enjoy. All right, that's my personal view. I'm sure everyone's got different opinions on it, but it's more just a balanced life than anything else.
Yep.
Yes.
What about if you're doing different style trainings? Like, because sometimes I'll do like a 6 a.m. spin, but then I'll come back and do a weight training in the evening.
Yeah, look,
like,
it's that's fine. It's not detrimental or anything, and if you enjoy it and you can cope with it, then that's fine. On those days, your food intake will need to be a lot higher because you're doing twice the sessions. But I mean, I wouldn't feel the need. If you can maintain it with your life and you're happy and you're enjoying it, then continue with it. If you get tired, you feel like you're not getting any results or anything, then just drop one of them and just do one. So again, it comes down to how your body feels. But I guess a lot of people, when they go into the weight loss phase and they're like, okay, I need to lose weight, I'm going to go to the gym at 6 a.m. and I'm going to do a class, and then I'm going to go again at 6 p.m. and do another class, that's not going to get you results. So if you enjoy it for a healthy life, then I think that's fine.
In saying that, if you sort of do that spin class in the morning and then you want to sort of build your muscles at night, they've sort of already been like taken of all their nutrients and they're ready to rest after that, because especially like a spin class is very full on your legs and things like that. Your stress levels will be elevated because it is a stress on the body exercise. So that creates a non-optimal environment for muscle growth and recovery. So they can sort of counteract, yeah, just to sort of add on. But again, we're not saying it's bad. If you're happy, feel good coming into the gym, that's the main thing. But if you do plateau, that could be an area to play around with. Yeah.
Cool. That makes sense, guys? Yeah.
What about how many times a week? Like, I know that, you know, there's a lot of guidelines out there around that, but also, like, how many days you should do consecutively, because, like, for myself, for example, I suffer a lot of delayed muscle soreness.
Yeah.
So I can't do more than, I should really rest after every 2 days. I can stretch to 3 maybe, but any more than that, I'm just dead.
Yeah.
Is there kind of, are you just supposed to listen to your body, or are you, can you, like, what damage do you do by pushing it when you are experiencing that?
Yeah, I think you definitely answered your own question. Listen to your body.
That's
right.
Right.
If you're wrecked after 2 days, then awesome. You've given everything that you can. Rest, let it recover, and then go for another 2 days. Then rest, let it recover. If you're still sore after 2 days, for 2 days, rest for 2 days, and then that's all fine. There's no certain optimal time to go to the gym. Definitely comes down to each individual person and how you feel after your training. If you're doing very intense training, then you're going to be on a lot lighter load than someone that's going and walking on the treadmill for 30 minutes every single day. All right, so if two days training and then a rest day works, then just do that and listen to your body. If you're tired, rest.
If you do that for long enough, eventually that won't cause the same amount of soreness, because the body adapts to whatever stress and stimulus we put to it, and then maybe you will be able to increase it. So it's sort of always about doing more without doing too much and just playing around with different things. So eventually you will be getting used to that amount of exercise, and then you could add in another day or could change your weight up and things like that. So it's always about tricking the body, essentially, because it just loves to adapt. Like, it will adapt from doing heavy squats to running on the treadmill. It just knows how to make life easier, essentially. So it's all about mixing it up and changing it up once the soreness stops, essentially. And everyone is different.
Yeah, pushing through will just cause injuries. So
if you're
doing squats and your legs are really, really sore and tired, then your quads will essentially go, I don't want to work, and it's going to recruit a muscle from somewhere else. And a lot of people have lower back pain because they don't allow enough rest time and their glutes and hammies aren't activating properly. So if you're just pulling muscles from different areas, and that's when we start to get kind of bent out of shape and everything. So you'll just cause injuries if you push through too much.
Are you doing any damage to your metabolism though? Because, like, if you're working different muscles on each day, and then, say, rather than having rest or having active rest, like just a walk or something like that, are you doing more damage than good in regards to your ability to burn fat and keep your metabolism going?
It just depends on the individual. So a person completely new to gym, if they did that, different body parts every day, they're going to have a hard time. But where someone that's been doing it for years, that probably is their optimal amount of training, because their body is so good at adapting and it's so used to all that stress being put on them. So it really just depends on your experience of training. So personally, because we've been doing this for years, personally I would do like legs one day, upper body the next day, things like that. But when I first started, 2-3 days a week, that was enough. Like, it was, yeah. So you slowly adapt over the years. Again, we're trying to get rid of this 8-week, 12-week, whatever challenges. This is years and life. Yeah, so again, everyone's different and you just got to keep playing around with what works. So listen to your body if it's really, really sore, and just change it up when you start getting used to your training. Yeah, that's when you can add more in. But you'll know if you're overtraining. You'll store your weight around those areas. Everyone's different when they store it, but you'll start storing the weight, you'll feel like crap. You'll stop getting results. You'll know. There's a difference between being unmotivated and genuinely hurting and like forcing yourself to go. So you just gotta listen to your body. Yeah. Okay, so with flexible dieting, there's a lot of stereotypes that you can eat anything, and essentially you can, but we've been really stressing today that there are optimal ways to do this. Okay, so we're not saying to cut anything out unless you're intolerant. That's the only reason you'll ever cut anything out, okay? Technically you can,
nutrient-dense whole foods will fill you up for longer, and then you'll be able to eat more, and you won't be starving by the end of the night once you reach your macros. So you're all going to put in your details in your phone. You'll get your sort of numbers that you're going to hit of protein, carbs, and fats, and that's our baseline. And then you fill it with what foods that suit your lifestyle, okay? So yeah, whole foods will keep you full up. It'll give you fuel and energy, and it'll repair you from your workouts, and then it's more sustainable. But if there are days where you want to go out to dinner, this takes that in account too. If you want to have like a little treat or something like that, you can. Yeah, it's fine. We just want to still stress that your micronutrients, vitamins, and minerals are still important. So you still need to eat your greens most of the time. That's legit. So 90% whole foods, 10% treats, just because we're human and, you know, we want to eat stuff that's not chicken and broccoli all day. Chocolates, whatever, yeah, it's all good. Ice cream, it's fine. If you add it in, if you track it, and don't overdo it, you'll still get results, 100%.
Alright, so supplements, okay, another big one that gets brought up. A lot of people, when they jump on, you think that, you know, you need to have all sorts of supplements. Supplements are just that, alright? You don't need them, they are there to supplement your diet, okay? So you can get everything that you need from food, but if you can't eat enough chicken breast, that's when a protein shake comes in, alright? So that's all it is an easier way to get that nutrient, because let's be honest, how many people do you see walking out of here holding a chicken breast on a fork because they need to get their protein in post-workout? No one. Chocolate tastes good, so we have a chocolate protein shake. Right, so that's what supplements are. Now, we're a little bit different in supplements. 100% protein, okay? So we all mostly under eat your protein. So a good protein powder will get you a hell of a lot of the way, all right? You can add it to smoothies, you can add it to oats, you can add it to a yogurt, all right? Actually, I'm glad I got a protein in the day, I just realized.
Yeah, there you go.
But there's some really good brands now. It used to taste crappy, now it tastes amazing. So there's a lot of good brands out there that you can use. Protein bars are also good. It's just a meal of protein instead of a shake, essentially.
Yep.
Just look out for sugars on a lot of them, but you'll be all right.
The ones we have here are really good. So
yeah
your supermarket ones are different. That's your marketing sort of things. And, you know, a lot of people don't read the labels, but the ones we have here are very low sugars, things like that. Then, yeah, they're good ones.
Yeah.
Have the ones down here. And, yeah.
Titan wafer bars, if anyone's looking, get on those.
I'm
amazing. Yeah, I like
amazing.
Amazing.
Have one of each. How one's better? Titan's good too. We're not sponsored.
Another one, caffeine. Okay, so caffeine pre-workout. I'm sure a lot of people take pre-workout because, you know, that's what you're supposed to do. You can have a coffee if you want. So pre-workout is just a big caffeine hit to get you pumped and up and going before you train. It's not essential, but I mean, I am very addicted to caffeine, so it is essential for me in my mind. But a lot of it comes into habits, all right? So before you train, you have your pre-workout, and then you train, and it just becomes a habit. You can get very adapted. You can adapt to pre-workout quite easily. So you'll hear people, oh, I cycle through pre-workouts. That just means that you change brand. Or have a spell off it or something like that, because with coffee as well, your body will get used to it, so you'll kind of become immune, I suppose.
Yep.
Right, so just be careful on that one. Other supplements, yes, there's plenty out there. Whether they're necessary or not, I don't know. It's up to each individual. BCAAs, I do take BCAAs. It is another protein source, so branched chain amino acids, and it just helps with your recovery. So maybe if you're feeling a little bit sore, do you have BCAAs? Jump on the BCAAs and it might help with your recovery a little bit. I find that there is a big difference between when I do and don't have them, so that might be awesome. All right, extend BCAAs. Very. Right,
and then, just to interrupt, because a lot of people still drink soft drink, which is fine, but I find they're a good replacement because it still tastes kind of sweet. They've got sweeteners in them, but you know, that helps replenish my cravings for things like that as well.
Would you have those just after you work out, or would you drink them throughout the course of the day?
They're optimal during the workout, but you can have them during the day too. Again, it's about reducing crazy cravings, and then if that's a replacement and if that's going to stop you drinking a lemonade, all for it, you know. Nothing's really good or bad, but yeah, there are optimal times to have everything, but there's nothing wrong with having it during the day. Again, it's just another thing that you can try.
Yeah. Yeah, and sometimes like a lot of, initially I found that having like a pre-workout and then protein after workout and BCAAs during workout, like it was really hard on my stomach too.
Much, yeah.
So it was a bit too much like, you know, artificial stuff. So it's okay now, which probably isn't a good thing, but it's okay now. So just, yeah, if you can't handle it during workouts, you prefer to throw down some water and just have it through the day. Right, other things, you've got creatine, you've got fat burners, you've got L-carnitine, you've got glutamine, you've got all these things, and all of them will assist in your building and your replenishment. Whether they're necessary or not, I'm not sure. I would say creatine is probably up there in the yeses, fat burners are probably down there in the nose, all right? But each to their own, and what suits you or what you enjoy is good. Fat burners are not going to burn your fat. You're not gonna take a sip of it and be magically, you know, thin and toned. Unfortunately, it doesn't work like that. Is just a lot of like green tea extract, some more caffeine and stuff like that. So it kind of, it gets you hyped and up and going, just gets the heart racing a little bit more. So I found those were a little bit hard on my stomach, and I don't take them. As I said, I only do the protein, BCAAs, and the pre-workout, the two supplements I take. So
but yeah,
a couple different ones.
You can get all this stuff. If you have a well-balanced diet, you don't need any of this. Honestly, it's a lot of marketing, and sorry to supplement companies and that out there, but again, we're talking for a general population. I need to stress that. You can get all this stuff from a well-balanced diet. This just helps with convenience. The liquid form stuff sort of helps it get absorbed quicker, so that's why we're all about the protein shakes post-workout, because by the time you digest the chicken or a protein sauce, you know, you're not going to get it as quick to your muscles. It's about that optimal environment, but have a well-rounded diet. We're not here to put supplements on you guys. But they're just extras and different options.
Supplement and diet.
That's right. Cool. Tips and tricks, meal prep. Okay, you would have heard it about it. It can seem overwhelming. I remember the first time I tried to meal prep, I was like, nah, this is trying to cook all my meals for the week. It stressed me out so bad. So I just started personally, cooked like a big pot of whatever for the next few days, a little bit of rice, just so I had something there. That's the underlying thing. You don't want to come home from work or your workout, you're starving, like, because that's when we just reach for the closest option. So we want to make that closest option a good meal. So that's what meal prep is. Convenience, consistency, you save time and money going out, it all adds up. If you pre-prep your meals, then yeah, you're winning. You're always a step ahead. You're less likely to drive past Macca's or something like that. In terms of when the best time to work out is, again, it's up to you. There's no point getting up at 5 a.m., you know, if you're only going to do it for 2 days and throwing the towel. So you're better off getting some sort of workout in than none, okay? Yeah, it's all about the long term. With macros, which we'll touch on how to find out your levels after. So set them the night before. It makes it hard if you wake up, you know your numbers you need to hit, but then you're just plugging in foods as you go. Chances of you hitting it are very slim. So before you go to bed, make sure you've got your foods for the next day set. You know exactly what you're eating, when you're gonna eat them, and then it's just one less thing you need to think about, and then you can continue living life and doing your daily things that you do. And buy kitchen scales, because that's what you use to weigh your portions, and then you type your portions into the app. Calculate how many grams of protein, carbs, and fats are in those foods. So, kitchen scales, make sure you have them.
Alright, so can still eat out. We're definitely not saying be a hermit and eat inside and cook all your meals for yourself. We are all human, and these are just some tips to have when you're eating out. Alright, so nowadays you can go on like the apps and the websites and stuff, and you can see the menu, so you can have a rough idea of what's going to be on the menu if you want to pre-look at it, and that would be good. All right, sauce on the side. Yes, you can be that pain in the bum person that asks for everything on the side. That's okay. Veggies without butter. A lot of restaurants now are doing that, and they're happy with that as well. So get your sauces on the side, and then you can also start with a basic meal and add ingredients in. Right, so if you're out for breakfast, for example, and you know the omelette looks really good, but you know it's a bit sus, then just create your own omelette. Right, so you can also build up your own meals. When we're talking, these ones are talking a little bit about MyFitnessPal. So overestimate what you're eating, because you can't go, well, you can probably with Macca's, but you can't go, you know, Rocco's Burger Cafe, Mexi Burger, and type it in. It's not going to find it. It's just not a thing, unfortunately. So when you start weighing your food and understanding how much carbs are in this and proteins in this and fats in that, you can have a rough idea of what you are eating when you're out. So overestimate it, because chances are there's a bunch of cooking oils in there, there's probably a lot of butter in there as well, which is going to drive up the calories. So you can still do it, but if you think that you're eating a burger and you're like, oh, it's only small, it's only 500 calories, you're probably looking more towards 700 or 800. So just overthink what you're eating, basically. Try to fill in the rest of your day, okay? So if you know you're going out for dinner on a Friday night, fill in on MyFitnessPal the rest of your daily macros, and then you have an idea of what kind of window you have there, okay? Don't give in to peer pressure. If you don't want something, don't eat it. If everyone's getting dessert and you don't want dessert because, you know, you might feel a little bit bad about it tomorrow, don't get dessert, okay?
Thank yourself. Not everyone understands, like, why you're so, you know,
why
like,
you're
oh, don't worry about it, just have one or just a little bit. The amount of times you're going to hear it, you just got to be, there's a way to go about it. Just like, look, sorry, this is what I'm doing now, and, you know,
Everyone's got different goals too. So,
yeah.
You know, if your friends or your family don't have the same goals as you, that's okay. You're not wrong, they're not wrong, no one's wrong. Everyone's living different lives. So, you know, remind yourself of your goals and why you're doing what you're doing. And you know what? This week you might go, oh, I'm not going to have dessert and I'll just have one wine. And next week you go, nah, I'm going to have two wines or three wines or whatever it might be.
Oh,
so, yes. So just back yourselves, guys. Like, do what you want to do and don't let others tell you otherwise, I suppose. But still enjoy going out. You know, it's something to look forward to. You can still be social. You know, we all want to have friends and family and stuff that we see. So don't lock yourselves in a cupboard and think you can't eat anything. All right? A donut does look good, though.
Oh, it was amazing. They're on my meals, by the way. They were good. All right. Being calorie aware. So we sort of touched on this before. This is a really good example. So 400 calories of oil in your stomach, not even touch the sides, okay? Chicken, a little bit more, veggies, you're gonna be nice and full because you get to eat more of them. So your stomach, when you eat, it stretches and that tells your brain that you're getting full. With the oil, it's not even gonna create that hormonal response and you're gonna be still starving. That's just an example. So we're gonna show some photos if you go to the next one. An example here, 500 calories in that burger on the right, 500 calories in the tuna, veggie salad over there on the left. So exactly the same amount of calories, but imagine trying to eat the left one compared to the right. You're still going to be so full. Hardly anyone orders one tiny burger on the right anyway. So chucking some chips, you brought it up to 900 calories, but we can add in a whole other plate of veggies, and that other plate's gotten like double the size as well. And then 1500 calories, again, you'd struggle to eat all that on the left, even in a day. Compared to the right, which could be like two meals worth or one for some. So again, we're not saying one's good, one's bad. You can take out a couple of plates of veggies and chuck a burger in. It's about mixing and matching, okay? But again, at the end of the day, we want to do something that will keep us full for longer as well. So that's just a really good visual of that there.
Yeah, and that's the whole, not all calories are created equally. So, you know, if you want to eat a crunchy, which I've sadly found out, there's like 250 calories in a crunchy, you can essentially have another meal. So then, you know, you just got to think to yourself, all right, like, is it worth it, I suppose? Do you really want it? Is it going to satisfy that craving? Are you going to feel good about it? If it's yes, 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 it's going to feel good, eat the crunchy.
Yeah.
All right? You guys are starting to understand what my daily diet is with crunchies and donuts and stuff like that. Titan bars. Alrighty, MyFitnessPal. Okay, so has anyone used it before? You've used it? A couple? Awesome. Alright, cool. So whip out your phones. Let's see what we've got on this. Probably should get rid of all her conversations.